But still, he's part of the team, isn't he?
Or at least, oh yeah, he is. But he's not in the car now because Henning Petersen just wrote a comment to the driver of, or not the driver, but the team Kitty on Facebook just now, and I don't think Henning will be on Facebook from the race car.
Oh, you don't? That would explain why you're slow.
But maybe Henning will go in the car for the last stint and see if he can make up two laps. But I don't know. It's looking quite good for Team Kitty. They have been a real joker here, because they have been a little bit hit or miss, but they seem to have found a lot of both stability and speed.
They have, yeah. And to be honest, they weren't that impressive during the practice in the past weeks. We've seen, we've seen Nicolai Pedersen. He's been with DGL for the most part of 2011.
Yeah.
But his teammates, this Hamsalia Mekko guy, he's entirely new as far as I'm concerned. And to be honest, he wasn't too stable in the practice sessions, but boy, they've really proven themselves in this race.
Yeah, maybe they just hit the right setup, and then once you get to the race, you can kind of hit the zone and get the best out of the car.
Yeah, that's very true. That's what I experience anyway.
Yeah.
You can practice a lot, but even if you're practicing, it's never more than just a couple of hours in an evening or something like that. And you've had your head everywhere else during the day. You've been working. You've been at school. Whatever.
Yeah.
It's nothing like sitting down for an entire weekend just driving, just racing. And I usually find during an event like this and the 24-hour event that 6-8 hours into the race I'm going considerably faster than I did at the start of the race and indeed in the practice. Sometimes even seconds.
That's a good sign when that happens, I think, and it's a sign that you are on a well prepared team. Where
the kitty card's skidding a bit there, he's losing out
right.
Left to set.
Maybe he hit some kitty litter. I don't know.
Oh, it hurts the pain. The more jokes we make, the less viewers we have, I think.
Yeah, but that's really saying more about the jokes than the viewers, I'm sure. I'm not entirely sure we're even admitting. I'm kind of hoping we aren't.
I can tell you we are, and we have been for a while. We have been for a while, and we have 20 people enjoying this, I can tell you.
Now we are in the last hour of the race.
We are indeed, and also I can just give you once here the Formula Yamaha car. I don't know if you can tell, but it's very light. There's no fuel left in it, which means I will actually have to leave you now because I have to drive the last stint.
All right. Well, so, I wish you the best of luck, Lasse.
Yeah, we have a little ace up our sleeves.
Well, just. As long as you keep the car on the track, I think you'll be fine.
Oh, I will. Anyway, I think for our precious 20 viewers who've endured the first 11 hours and are still with us, I think we started out with something like 40, 45 viewers. I'm impressed. But you lot of 20 viewers still left, thank you for enduring it, and I hope, this has been the most interesting hour of commentating yet.
Yeah, I think the fight between Casper and or the 10-man project and Bernie Racing was probably the top of it. But yeah, I had a good time, and we now know that the halftime of a Sim Race TV viewer is around these 11 hours. So lesson learned.
The decay time of a Sim Race TV viewer.
Yeah, exactly.
Anyway. Have a nice last hour of the race.
Yeah, thank you, and you too. Good luck.
Thank you.
Right now, we cannot see this, but the Formula Yamaha E1 car, which is leading its class, is in the pits, and Lasse is entering the seat. When he said he had an ace up his sleeve, I think a lot of us know what he's talking about. I think he's talking about that best lap time of GT. Right now, as it stands, the 10-man project has a 154.11. And the Yamaha has a 154.26. So I think what Les is going for now is definitely going to be the hot lap. And I know that the 10-man project is also going for that. But if anyone has to do it, I'm glad it's those guys. I know they can do this without doing anything dangerous. And I think it'd be interesting to see who actually wins that battle.
Hello, Alex.
Hello, Peter.
So, what's been happening in the race while I've been driving?
Welcome to the last hour. Well, actually, most of the last hour has been debates about different kinds of simulations, not all race-related. So, I think right now it's time to really get into the race this last hour. And get into the mechanics of this thing. We have the most
perhaps you can guess why I asked then.
Yeah? Why do you ask, Fred?
Is this the battle for the lead that we're watching at the moment?
What we are watching is the battle for Team Kitty to be a full two laps ahead of FTZ, and they actually were for a moment, and Lasse and I were talking about how impressive what Team Kitty has done, considering the experience of the FTZ car with Geert Nielsen and Henning Petersen. What Kitty has done is really impressive, and if they can pull this off, we will all be probably impressed, because they are quite new.
Yes, I think if you add up the entire number of laps that both drivers of the Team Kitty car has done, they haven't even done a half of one of the drivers in the FTC car.
Yeah, that's really true. Of course, there's some luck involved, like the FTC car had a disconnect and so on. But still, it's very impressive, and as we can see now, Kitty is not just two laps ahead, they're two laps ahead, and now actually they are really full two laps ahead, not just 1.99 laps. So they're actually right now, and now they're going to the pits. That's very interesting.
Can they complete these last 50 minutes on one tank of diesel?
That's interesting. We can actually see that if we look at the lap times and how many laps they can do in a stint.
I don't think they can. I think they should use about just 47 minutes.
They do 23 laps in a stint, so I'd have to agree. They can't. They'd have to stop again. The question is then if FTZ can do just one more stop.
This means that if FTZ stops on the next lap, they can't do it either. But if they do one more lap, then I guess they are home safe and only have to do one more stop.
Possibly, yeah. Possibly. Maybe they need a couple more. I'm not quite sure on that. It kind of depends on their strategy. But that might be... we're in the last hour now, so we might see different strategies. We might see short shifting. We could see double stinting the tires and so on.
But that change of strategy would only come from the class leaders and not very likely from the guys trying to catch up. They are most likely still going all in.
That sounds plausible. Actually, one thing I'm waiting for is for the race control to say something about when the race ends, because actually the start of the race was postponed by a few minutes, so right now I think a few people are waiting for the race control to say something about whether if the race ends at exactly midnight or if the end will actually be postponed a couple of minutes more.
Well, as you know from the GTR 24H rules, I think race control will declare that the race starts or ends at exactly midnight.
That's what I'm expecting as well, and I think we'll hear confirmation on that soon as well. And also, I think there might be a final instruction from the race control on what to do when the race ends. Like, I think a parade formation lap would be a nice thing to do.
I would definitely agree with that. I see here that we've been joined by Henrik from the Black Arrow SimSport team, and also it must be Kasper who's back again from the 10-man project.
Good evening.
Good evening. So, Henrik, you've been watching the race and not participating so much. What do you think about what you've been watching?
I think it's been quite an interesting race, both in the LP class and the GC class. Both in the way that the list and the Ford GT, how they could battle, even though that the list fuel consumption have been a bit better than the Ford GT. However, the Ford GT somehow seems a bit faster.
Well, let's look and watch. Follow closely in the live timing now, because I know that Lasse is at the moment going for the fastest time.
Nice. So is he pushing at the moment, I guess?
He is pushing his very best.
He's pushing like a madman. That's the usual thing from him.
And just a few moments ago, he has actually taken the best lap.
Nice.
You're right. 1:54.0. 10-man now has a tenth of a second to catch up.
And again, the best that they have done is 1:54.1.
Yeah, it's close, but their best lap was 8 or 10 hours ago.
Yeah. Well, I guess all the drivers is pretty tired at the moment.
They need special motivation problem.
Yeah.
It's actually pretty interesting to be following this kitty car from the onboard camera, and you notice how bumpy the track actually is, and I've one notice a very big difference in how bumpy the track is in an LMP car compared to what I'm used to in the GT car. in the GT car you don't really feel the bumps, except for the last turn, Sunset Bend and Corner 1. The rest of the bumps you don't really notice, but it looks quite bumpy from here.
Well, it is bumpy, especially if you're going for the burst of second gear corners. The exit there, it's really bumpy, and the car tends to bottom out a bit with all the MP cars there, so...
I just got an update from the race control on the Facebook group. They're saying that the race will indeed end at midnight, meaning that when the race leader passes the line at midnight, his race is over, and everyone else's race is over as soon as they pass the line after that. And we are asking everyone to please stay in the order they were when they passed the line and the race is over. Just to do a beautiful parade lap. If you don't have enough fuel for it, you'll just drive and run out at some point. But a parade lap where you maybe blink your headlights and wave out the window to the fans would be a nice way to end the live stream and this great race as well.
So, and what an audience of spectators. I don't believe I've ever seen this many pictures being taken at any motor race.
Yeah, the flash photography is quite intensive. Even at the beginning of the day in broad sunlight, they were using the flashes to show they were there.
And not to mention the amount of fireworks.
Yeah, that's incredible.
It's an awesome amount of fireworks that happened at camp.
Thousands and thousands of rockets were fired.
It's not even the only place they're using fireworks. There's a lot of places around the track, you just don't notice them as much, but in that particular turn by the hairpin corner there, they've gone all in on fireworks.
I got so happy first time I passed it in the safety car for the first outlap. I really felt it was a nice atmosphere for the race.
Yes, I think that's a general thing here on Sebring. It has that special atmosphere, and that doesn't matter if it's a small online race or if it's the real thing. There's a bit of that atmosphere that's just somehow hangs on and is contagious, like the real Le Mans race or perhaps the 24-hour race at the Nürburgring. There's just something special about those races.
I think I have the same word with the digital community. I mean, it is something special. I never found it in the other leagues I've been driving in, and I wouldn't change it for anything.
No, Les and I were talking about that a lot in the last hour, that I believe in March this year, DGCL will be 7 years old. I was teasing Lasse a little bit, saying that we've seen boys grow to men here and also seen men break down and cry over their losses in some of the races. But definitely it has been a long time, and a lot of us know each other quite well. And it's been more than just an internet game or simulation.
Yes, indeed.
Of course, this to me is a hobby and a sport. So yes, like any other sport you participate in, you will find new friends. And I've just been shouted at by Lasse, who's just done a 1:53.840.
Wow. So that actually.
That's the fastest GT lap by quite a bargain.
That's 2/10 on the qualifying.
That's actually very impressive.
Yes.
And it's in the dark.
It's fine.
Well, he is the Knight Rider, so what can you expect? Actually,
I bet that's a change. That's a change of call sign. He was McLovin before this, so now he's the Knight Rider.
I think the McLovin name kind of died as Leslie grew older, but there was one point where there was a striking similarity just around when that movie came out. That was too funny for some of us, but a bit cruel.
What? McLovin's the guy, he's the man.
he is. And Leslie is the man. He is our night driving expert. He's the one who... the guy on this team who prefers night driving for the 24-hour races the most, I think, and I don't know, somehow he can just get the best out of the car in the night. Maybe the fact that in real life it would be faster due to the colder air has some kind of placebo effect on him, I don't know. It just seems to work out.
But it looks like the 10-man project has either the driver made a mistake or they've given up on the project of getting the fastest lap, because the last lap time was a 1:56.9. It's not a slow lap, but it doesn't resemble an attempt of taking the fastest lap.
No, then you'd expect like a 1:53 or maybe a 1:50, because you crashed the car trying to
yeah. either really fast or really slow.
Yeah, you wouldn't expect just a nice sensible lap time.
And by now those two guys should of course have realized that you can't take fastest lap time by driving sensible.
Oh yeah, I think so.
Like a madman.
Possessed by the spirit of Sebring. Well, I think I can safely say that this race has been better than I expected. It's had more restarts than I expected to, more safety cars. But overall, when you look at the end result, I don't think these restarts have had any effect at all. It's been pretty much equally shared around among the cars, maybe except for your car, Henrik, who's been unfortunate enough to not even drive a quarter of the race.
Well, at the last restart, we just didn't bother coming on to the track again.
No, that was clearly a shame, and your race was clearly ruined by bad internet connectivity. That's too bad, because I know when we saw from your lap times that you would definitely have been a contender for the win.
Well, I might have been. Well, my fuel economy wouldn't have been a bit of an issue, but then again, the speed will counter-affect that, so... But I would really have liked to see how that will compare, the speed versus the economy. But, hell,
maybe we'll see in October.
Maybe.
Actually, if I can give my German friends Karwick Strunk a tip, it'd be to either turn down their brake cooling or move their brake balance back. And I'm noticing only their front brake discs are becoming red. Mostly everyone else is heating up the brakes more equally. And I think. Or in my experience, what happens when you have too much brake pressure in the front, the car will be a little bit easy to drive, because when you lock the brakes, you tend to lock the front ones. If the brake bias is too much in the front, what will happen is the front brakes will overheat and start to perform poorly, and the rear ones will actually be the best. So having those brakes that heat a lot more in one end of the car will actually make the way brakes change as they heat up. It looks like their car is only using the front brakes almost.
Yes, we've had this problem a lot on the Le Mans track. It because we have long straights that cooling brakes down very well, and then braking zones that require braking from plus 300 kilometers an hour to 120. That's very heavy braking, which puts a lot of energy into the brake discs. So if you do not have the right balance, the right cooling balance, you will end up overheating, and in the worst case you overheat your front brakes, and then only the rear brakes work, and you will spin out.
Can I ask if you made any of the skins used in this race other than for the Formula Yamaha Lister that you're driving?
No, I did not make any of the skins.
Okay. So all the other ones provided their own skin?
No, this the Team Bernie Ferrari is the standard Ferrari. It's the standard GTR24H skin.
All right.
And also Henrik and Carsten was driving the standard skin of the Epsilon Euskadi.
I just noticed now that the Germans had a Simutils decay logo on the foot of their Corvette. I was quite happy.
Yeah, that's who made that one.
This is the exact same skin they drove at the GTR 24H.
Also, Steen Sonic, he's also driving a standard skin.
The custom skins do add a lot to the atmosphere of the game, though. It really you might, if you're not used to this, think that it doesn't matter, it's all about the driving and so on. But it's a nice addition to the spirit of the thing, and makes it easy to recognize your opponent, and all of a sudden it becomes more personal. You really feel that it's a human being in the races.
Like playing for your flag or playing for a national team, it's for it's in your blood now.
I think you guys right on the spot there, and I think that's exactly what it is about this way of sim racing and league racing that has caught the entire sim racing community by storm here in the last 10 years. It is not only the racing, it is the entire communities that are built around the racing.
I have to agree with that.
People who are interested in motorsports and interested in particular forms of motorsport all come together, gathered together by their interests.
I totally agree that. I also find that the challenge that there is in the next race in the races, because in the most races, or definitely this league, we all know each other, and it's always the greatest challenge is always the next one, also in this league, when we're racing against each other, because at times really, really close. So it's always that little small difference that makes a big one.
Yes, and I've been racing other places. iRacing especially is very different than this kind of racing. In iRacing you don't really know the guys you're racing against, at least I don't, and that removes a lot of the atmosphere from the racing. I know the guys I'm racing at GDTL. I know which one of the drivers are better than me, and I know which ones are not as good as me, so I have a personal target all the time, not only just to win races, but to finish above the people that I know are slightly better than me. So no matter if I win races or not, there's always a goal for me that's achievable, and I get happy when I achieve my goals. Well, Les must have won out the soft front tires on his car, because the lap times, well, they're not bad, but they're not in the 153 area anymore.
So, what do you think, is there any teams or any drivers who have really done special performance in this race?
I think we still, even though it's now many hours ago, Jeppe from the team Ezeon stopped driving, I still think we have to mention him in this context. And like Alex has been saying, the drivers from the team Kitty DK car also should be mentioned here. I think it is incredible for a couple of young drivers like them to pull off this victory as it looks right now.
Yeah, I have to agree with that. They really deserve a big applause for that.
I have to say, Team Kitty, as well. Just because from listening to the Formula Yamaha team speak, when I heard Michael Wikström saying "Så, nu kommer missen," and similar things, that just made my day. And all those different contexts that you can put that joke in, he did. And yeah, it's just wonderful. And seeing that puke ugly car, to be honest, is just magical, because they're just doing it, and it looks like they're gonna win, and it's amazing.
There's that paint job and that livery, and then winning
it
with it's just like in your face.
It very much is.
And then, of course, you could mention the two drivers from the FTC car too, because they are perhaps exactly the opposite of the Team Kitty drivers. They are not at all young drivers. I don't even think they would
they
be. I don't even think they would be offended by us calling them old.
They are. That's the right way of putting it.
They're seasoned. They're seasoned.
Yes, well seasoned. The well-seasoned drivers of Team FTC. Yes, that's perhaps the correct term.
They are incredibly stable. The Kitty team might be faster on some laps, but like if you take the 20 worst laps of both teams, I'm sure you see that FTC was better. So they have really have the driving style and attitude down that's required for 12 and 24 hour race, and I think them not being in the lead now is down to bad luck because of that disconnect, and also if they had to overcome the disconnect, they would need just a little bit more speed. They have done very well, I'd say.
Yes, and what they don't have in speed and experience, they also have in dedication, because I think these two guys are so dedicated to this racing.
Indeed, I used also to be part of that FTC team, and they are really dedicated, and they really work hard when they're getting down on the track. I mean, whew.
They're not afraid of ambition either, and I think that's what you need to drive yourself and the team forward. That is ambitions. If you do not admit to yourself that winning is your ultimate goal, and you don't get everyone behind that, the minute someone starts to say no, it's just for fun, then I don't think it's possible to keep the dedication anymore.
I have to agree that. I mean, you still have to have that level of seriousness and confidence in what you're doing, otherwise it would just be for fun to compete at this level. Although the racing also in the leagues like the GCL and the GCR 24-hour race. Yes, it is for fun. However, it is quite serious and close racing.
Yes, it is on the track, but as we mentioned, there's a community going on, you know, off track and in the practice sessions. That's
best of friends.
That's on a, yes, on
a
different
level. Be after the race. I mean, something
exactly
like that.
Now I'm back from racing.
Awesome. Welcome back then.
So, thank you.
You've had your last pit stop too?
Yeah. And I was very, very pleased when I beat my own head lap, but I see that Lasse has pulled someone out of his sleeve or something. I don't know
yeah.
what it is he's pulled out.
0.3 of a second he actually beat you by. So
yeah, that's pretty impressive.
Quite an improvement. But still nice of you to beat yours, and I guess you were quite close to beating him. They only had a couple of laps that were faster than your best one.
Yeah, I thought that I just finished it off when I beat my own. But then a couple of laps later, Chris could tell me that now he was going very, very fast, Lasse.
Yes, I know exactly what got into him. A set of soft tires got into him, or not into onto his car. I'd rather say the other thing's
okay.
Nasty.
That explains. So, Kasper, how do you think your project is going? Your 10-man project, or 2-man project, or 1-man project, depending on how you read it.
Yeah, it's going quite well, but I think after this DCL season we'll have to shut it down. We have been offered a spot on a very ambitious team.
I noticed that you had some new stickers on your car.
Yeah, I thought they were in the right place.
Yeah, so on the ass end of your car, if I may say so. You have it
the rear end, please.
All right. On the rear of the car, there's a Team DGCL Racing, and just behind that, there's a not driving fast, just flying low logo.
Yeah.
So, we're happy to welcome you to the team in just about 23 minutes. We just need to.
Well, if you do it in 22 minutes, then DGCL will have first and second in this race.
We might have to consider.
Yeah.
We shall have a team speak with team management.
Yeah,
yeah.
We'll have to do that. Yeah, but I think the stickers were appropriate this time.
Did you also get the message from race control about a parade lap after the race finishes at midnight?
No, I think you'll have to repeat that for me.
Yeah, I'll race control will write it in the chat at some point, but we expect.
Will interrupt here to say that the Formula Yamaha car has just had a quick splash and dash with a very precisely calculated fuel load that is in just enough to make it to the end of the race.
As I was saying, when the race finishes, I expect all the cars to just keep driving past the finish line and have a bit of a wave at the audience and honk their horn and blink their lights and so on to say thanks to all the literally millions of fans out there viewing
and taking photos, apparently.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
That's noted.
And using an entire Danish national budget on fireworks.
Yeah, at least. In case someone is wondering why we are not reporting more on the standings and overtakings and so on, then that's really because the dynamics of the race haven't really changed the last hour and a half or so. People have kind of settled into their positions, and the 2 and 3 lap gaps we've been seeing between the different cars have remained more or less unchanged, other than the normal rubber band effect we see due to different pit stops and so on. But of course, follow the live timing on mutils.dk for the rest of the race, and I'm sure it's possible for some changes to happen, but for the last long time it's been quite stable, and what we see now is more or less what we expect to see at the end of the race, unless someone really makes some big mistakes.
Yes, in all honesty, someone will have to make a major driving mistake for something to change the running order.
Yeah, but actually I just had a discussion with my teammate here, and I think I'll have the last 10 minutes in the car to try to beat Les's best time.
Oh, so we have a good chance of a huge driving mistake and lots of excitement then.
Exactly.
please be safe, mate, and I know you will be, but we're looking forward to seeing what you can do with the fiery Ford.
And of course, with regards to our spectators, we are hoping for a huge mistake.
Yeah, I believe you do, Peter.
Atomic bomb effects will be expected.
Well, since we were the fastest GT car in the qualifying, I think it would be appropriate for us to try to go all the way and take the best lap in the race too. And to do it in the dark in the last 10 minutes, I think that's just to underline the classiness of our endurance skills.
You have to do it on the last lap. That's
exactly
the way to do it. Anything less.
So it's very manly, even though you don't have any any hair on your chest, there'll be hair on your car, or
everywhere will there be hair.
That sounds wrong.
I don't know how to make a car resemble anything like that.
Well, I just leave your attention to my to the hot lap list, and Chris has just done a 1:53.848, which is 8 thousandths off the time by the Lister Storm.
And he also did an amazing drift just a moment ago.
Yeah, and I know that's something you like, Alex.
Oh yes, that's all I know how to do. I instead of what normal or what racing drivers do, basically, which is to go in slow and go out of the corner fast, I guess, kind of go in quite hot and go out sideways, just for fun, and that's how I do the training.
I remember the half an hour long discussion with the Danish racing with the Danish racing driver between this racing driver and you, Alex, that continued a discussion about going sideways. That it was fun, and then he asked, but it's not very fast, but it's still fun, and it just kept going on.
exactly.
There were different arguments along that line, but mainly half an hour. It's fun.
Yeah.
Well, it's not very fast.
But it's fun.
Well, it's fun.
Yeah.
Well, I think right now Chris is crossing the line for his last go on the for a fast lap.
And guess who's catching him up from behind?
Not gonna happen.
Look,
this will
in the picture there.
Interesting. Just to really quickly sum up, in the LMP class, there's a 2-lap difference between the leader, Team Kitty, and second place, FTZ, and that's all we have in LMP. In GT, it's Formula Yamaha. 3 laps behind them, it's the 10-man project. 1 lap behind them, we have Bernie Racing, and that's actually almost 2 laps behind. And behind Bernie we have 8 laps further down, Team Colling 3, and 5 laps after them we have the German Kaubik Strunk. So still, it looks like that's the way it's going to stay. But the fastest lap seems to be the issue right now in the GT class. I think in LMP, Team Kitty is actually 4 seconds faster than FTZ on their fastest lap, so I doubt that's going to change.
And we have to remember that the Black Arrow Simsport is yet another 1.5 seconds faster than that.
Yeah, so I think the GT fast lap is what our eyes are on now, and it's what the hottest cars in the GT class are going for right now, because the standings are too hard to change, or yeah, it's just unlikely to do anything else.
This is just too great right now.
Yeah, we have only 15 minutes left.
We have a new best lap.
Oh, that's incredible.
That's
1
right.
Minute 53.712.
That's 1 cent from qualifying.
Chris actually did it. That's amazing.
That's pretty
done,
amazing, I think.
Have to say, well done.
Very
well done indeed.
That's like 3 seconds faster than the normal race laps of this race.
It's fine. Always save the best for the last.
It will be interesting to see the very last laps, if something exciting
breaking
pops
up.
I know from and I can hear in my earpiece here from the team management of the Formula Yamaha that they are indeed going to make an extra pit stop for a set of soft tires all round, and a just very small, almost fume-like load of fuel, and then they will make another attempt.
Nice.
Nice, then it will be all out at the end for the best lap.
As these two cars, the 10-man project and the Formula Yamaha, is indeed going very fast at the moment. They are, both cars are on the last lap under 1 minute 53 seconds. I think maybe Chris is now outside the window where it's possible to give it another attempt.
Yeah, I think you're right.
But he's still running below 1 minute 55 lap times, and that is still just about a second faster than a normal race lap in this race.
Yeah, you're right.
Now there's a development in the race. Team Kitty are pitting in now for what must be their last pit, unless something goes really wrong. They are the leader in LMP. FTZ 2 laps behind, but they have, I think, had their last pit stop. I'm pretty sure they have. So FTZ might now be able to make up one of the laps, but they'll probably still be a lap behind.
Yes, indeed.
So they won't catch up.
And exactly there. Now FTZ is only 1 lap behind.
Yeah. Well, actually, now they are just under 2 laps behind.
Yes, just
and
as I said, they're
well.
one lap behind on the lap timing. That means that they have to do almost 2 laps to catch up.
Yeah, but then again, they have they might as well, if they kept up nicely in the pit strategies, they might have to do another pit stop. So The FTC car, I don't know, I haven't thought that so.
It's like Rikidi is repairing damage because they had a very long pit stop.
Well, I'll be off for my definitely last stint.
And, yeah, well, good luck, Kasper.
See you after the race.
Yeah.
This is turning out to be quite interesting.
Could be interesting.
And if I am not mistaken, the Formula Yamaha car is just pitting in right now to change to their soft strategy and a very small load of fuel.
Yes, they are parked in the pit right now.
This will be quite exciting. Of course, I have some inside information on the car because at the current temperature, he may not be able to get the soft tires up to a proper working temperature on just one warm-up lap.
How cold is that on track?
If he overcooks this second counting lap, his third and prime lap, the tires will overheat. So he may get two fairly fast laps, but not one really fast one, depending on if he gets his tire. He needs to get the tires up to operating temperature on this lap in order to get a good lap.
Peter, do you know how warm the track is at the moment? Approximately.
If I remember correctly, we are around 37 degrees.
That's quite hot.
On night racing it is, definitely
it
very
is.
Hot.
It's Dubai hard in nights.
It's the anti-sun, the dark matter sun that's shining down on the track.
It's something like somebody just blew a big nuke somewhere.
But it definitely looks like he's pushing the car. he's even turning from side to side on the back straight to heat up the tires.
Nice. But he might only get one shot at it, so.
Yes, and worst of all, he may be
he may actually be right behind
the 10-man project car when he has this attempt.
Yeah, and he might have two hot tires to go for
now.
Oh,
take him,
yeah. Ooh, he might do as well.
Oh, they're very close now.
Yeah, very close now.
Of course, the 10-man project car being four laps behind now, but still.
Well, still, in the battle for fastest lap, this doesn't really...
It's not a bad position now, just for fastest lap.
Yes, exactly.
Luckily, we can keep him on one camera, or close to it.
Well, and Kasper is, of course, on his warm-up lap, and he may be battling exactly the opposite situation of what the Lister was. He may need to actually slow even further down, not to overheat his tires at the end of the warm-up lap. So, guys, what do you think? Do you think Lasse will take the fastest lap this time around?
He might do, he might not. I don't know. Can't tell now. He might do it. These 3 seconds still by LMP can't say second sector. That's a good lap, then.
I think he did it there. Yes, he did. Yeah, 153.426.
That's 0.3 of a second ahead of 10 man.
Let's look at them and see what their answer to this will be.
They are using the full width of the road for sure.
Yes, neither of these drivers are joking about this, for sure.
Why should they? Also, the Tsinkidi car, that's also going quite fast at the moment. The last time I posted was 146.6, which is only 200 of a second slower than that fastest lap. So they're also going, I guess, for the fastest lap of the race.
Yeah, it looks like it.
So they might as well try to beat our boss's lap time.
Well, Casper's lines were definitely very, very good through this this last sector. So we'll see what he can do in the Sunset Bend, the corner that eludes all racing drivers.
That's very nice lines indeed. I just saw it on the live stream. That's very nice lines.
I think we can note now that it's been done. The thing that's been eluding drivers for 50 years around this track has just been cracked wide open by Casper Hogaard. This is really like finding the holy grail of Sebring. I think he did a perfect sunset bend, a thing which no one else has done before.
It was beauty.
And
he was quite close to Nessa's time.
He did improve.
0.2
of a second in it now. But maybe his tires are good enough for another one, we don't know yet. Overcooking.
But as you can see, Lasse can actually decide right now if he wants to give Casper a chance or he doesn't. Because he could just slow a little bit down right now, and then there wouldn't be enough track or enough free space for Casper to make an attempt at this.
But knowing him,
he's not going to do that.
He wouldn't do that. Not just because he's a nice guy, but just because he doesn't slow down for anything.
No, I think exactly you're right, Alex. I don't even think, as you say, because he's a nice guy, I think he's always trying to go as fast as he can, and I don't really think there's much more in that car at the moment, because his tires are probably way above the 100 degrees Celsius.
But Casper could actually gain a little bit of slipstream now that could gain him a small fraction at the end if he gets close enough.
I think he has to go closer than that.
Oh yeah, not yet. And
team management is actually worrying about this at the moment. Holy moly, he did a 52.
Wow, Casper.
52.7.
So now 10 man is way faster.
Good, very good.
And
that's almost precise half a second.
Yeah, that's incredible.
That's okay, amazing. So that's two tries left, but most of them. Yeah, 2 minutes left.
Les is complaining at the moment that in during his practice he did a 52.4 lap and he just doesn't seem to be able to repeat that. Right now we're actually just around 2 minutes or 1.5 minutes from race end. So, for sure, if this is not a really fast lap from Lasse, then he won't be able to to take back the fastest lap.